What a delight it is to see each and every one of you as we gather together for worship this first Sunday after Christmas. What a joy it is to be gathered in the Lord's house this morning. We have a few announcements we want to bring to your attention. One thing that we want to mention is that this evening, our 6 o'clock evening Vesper service will not meet, and we will also not have our children's ministry or youth tonight in light of the Christmas holidays. We also want to mention that the poinsettias are available for pickup today following this service. You can grab one as you are preparing to leave, but they are available. We also want to remind everyone to please know that there is still time to turn in your financial pledge before 2022 arrives, and you can also make contributions for the 2021 year. If you have any questions about that, we encourage you to speak to Nancy Fairgreave at the church office this Monday or to email any questions that you have. If mailed, be sure that contributions be postmarked on or before December 31st if you wish to make a 2021 contribution. At this time, I would like to invite Dr. Tim to come forward for a special announcement we have.
Good morning. As you can see that Reverend Douglas and I and most of the choir, as they did last week as well, we're wearing masks, and most of you got an email this week. You know, for 22 months, the bishop said, well, Tim, you're the PIC, the pastor in charge, which is what the Book of Discipline says. But this past Tuesday, our bishop made a decision in consultation with the director of epidemiology for the state of South Carolina that we would go back to wearing masks. Now, I will say this, and this is something he said. I can't make you wear a mask. You know, we're open church. We invite everyone to attend. The only time that we can invite people to not attend is if they cause a breach of peace. And our ushers will take care of that matter if I don't take care of it first. So anyway, we want you to be protected. So his great hope and my great hope is that we will only be wearing these for a few weeks and that this will be something that passes through quickly. It already seems to appear that the folks in South Africa have already been past the Omicron variant surge and are on the downside of that. And so hopefully this will be something that we can do just for a short period of time. Of course, last year I hoped that we would be back at Easter services in time. But we all know too many people who have COVID. We know too many people who have lost loved ones, members of this church who have died from COVID. And so we want to be sensitive. As a matter of fact, you may notice that it's Reverend Douglas and I today. Butch is not on vacation, but he is just a few moments ago had a COVID test because of some symptoms. So we pray for him that everything is fine. So we're very sensitive to this. I just want us to be aware of that. The other thing that I want to say is I want to say a special word of thanks, not only for your understanding and being sensitive about these masks and so forth, and we all long for the day when we don't wear them, but I want to thank not only you all for your support of the church through this past year, and God bless you, and I pray that all of us have a better 2022, and pray that the Lord blesses us. But I want to say thank you to all the different persons, from our ushers, from our 8:30 service, our 9:02 service, our 11 o'clock service, even at our Vesper service, and the musicians and all those. I mean, we had a marvelous cantata last week, so thank you all for what you all did. And we're grateful for all the ways that the band, we had a wonderful Christmas Eve service at the fairgrounds, and my hope is that we will have a Christmas Eve service that will be back in the sanctuary next year, and we'll do that till kingdom come. But we will also have some sort of service as an outreach, whether it be at the fairgrounds or somewhere, for the Aiken community, because we saw many people on this past Friday evening that don't usually come to this church, and we welcome them. So we will continue to do that. But I do want to say thank you to all of our persons who've helped, from our acolytes on both sides to everyone else who've been a part of making Advent 2021 and Christmas, this Christmas Day celebration, such a marvelous event. So thank you very, very much.
At this time, I would like to invite us all to please stand as you are able as we sing our opening hymn, hymn number 234, O Come All You Faithful.
Thank you.
invite you to remain standing as we affirm our faith together with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Be seated. At this time, I invite our ushers to come forward for a time of tithes and offerings. Once the ushers are in place, we invite the crucifer to lead our children out for Children's Church.
Just a word of announcement. You may have seen Reverend Butch's wife, Karen, slip up beside me. Reverend Butch tested negative, so we're grateful for that. Yeah. Let's go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, on this Christmas Sunday, we give you thanks that your advent has occurred, that you came as the child, but you grew to manhood, you healed and proclaimed the kingdom, you cast out evil, and you died upon a cross for our sins. And you rose again to defeat death and to bring resurrection hope to all people. You ascended into heaven and you're seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, interceding for us, speaking up on our behalf. And you will come again to set all things right. Oh Lord, forgive us when we sometimes portray that we know better than you know, and we divide ourselves one against the other. Well, Lord, help us to know at the foot of the cross, the ground is level. No one is better than anyone else. We all stand in need of your grace. We all fall prostrate before you in humility, seeking your favor. And especially as we anticipate the coming of a new year before we next meet again, we pray, dear God, that you might bless our 2022, that you might cause us to remember all the things that have occurred in 2021 and all the years before, that we might retain all that is good. But Lord, help us to leave behind that which is not. Forgive us of our sins, the things that we've done that we should not have done, the thoughts we've thought. Oh, dear God, have mercy upon us and free us. Wipe our slates clean so that we might enter the new year with freshness and joy and possibility, hope realized. We pray, dear God, for all those who are sick, who are undergoing sufferings, those who are anticipating treatments, who are continuing treatments. Lord, we pray that this year and next year, 2022, might be a year of jubilee, of victory, of health restored and hope and faith in humanity restored. Oh, dear God, we pray for our country and we pray for our world. We pray for this planet, this cosmos, grand as it is, that your love might be shed abroad in all hearts, everywhere, that we might know your presence. Emmanuel, God who is with us, who has come to save us. So, Lord, be with us all, we pray. We bring glory to you. Our purpose here today is to worship you. This is our prayer. In Jesus Christ's name, the one who taught his disciples and has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. I'd like to invite you to stand for our gospel reading, as you're able. From Luke's gospel, the second chapter, verses 1 through 20. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world, because this was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And she wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord, and this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." And so they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. We recorded a movie back in November. It was a Christmas movie. I mean, after all, you know, Christmas starts somewhere around Halloween time or before. And when I was on a mission trip in the Philippines, they start celebrating Christmas and putting up Christmas trees September 1st, if you can imagine. But we DVR'd, we recorded a movie that we just happened to watch finally last night. The Family Christmas Tree. In it, without divulging too much information so as to keep you from watching it to find out on your own what happens, in it, a father finds out that 32 years prior, he had fathered a child. And through DNA testing, this child comes back into their lives, in his life in particular, and his family, her stepbrothers and sisters, her stepmother. He stands before a Christmas tree, but he says, this Christmas, and looking at his newfound daughter, he says, "This year, the most important tree is the family tree." Now, I know some of you might be like me and have some difficulties with some of the people in your family tree. And there are lots of fruits and nuts in most everybody's family tree, to be honest. But this gospel from Luke, this good news, lets us know that we're all connected, that we're all a part of the same family. We're all a part of the same family, and we all need Jesus. We all need Christ. We need the hope that Christ provides for us. It is so true. It is so true. The most important tree is the family tree. As a matter of fact, what Luke does is different from Matthew. And Matthew, in his genealogy of Jesus, he takes Jesus' genealogy back to Abraham, the father of the Jewish nation, because he wants to send a message to all of his fellow Jews that Jesus is the Messiah. He's the King of the Jews and the King of the world. It's Matthew who has the wealthy wise men show up at a house in Bethlehem. But Luke's gospel takes the family tree of Jesus all the way back to Genesis, to Adam. Because Luke's point is that all of us are related, that we're all kin to Jesus, and we're all kin to each other. We're all related, and we all need the Christ child. Perhaps this year, maybe for some of you more than ever before, but there have been different times in all of our histories when the message of good news has been more needed. I don't know how many of you have ever heard of John C. Campbell Folk School. Some of you have been to John C. Campbell Folk School between Franklin and Murphy, North Carolina, and Brasstown. It's just a little small village. But the Folk School has been operated since the early 1900s. It's been a place ever since the early 1900s where people from the surrounding communities and others who could pay their way would come and learn crafts so as to help the people of Appalachia be able to make a living. And so they learned how to quilt. And so even to this day, they have a fabric arts section. They would learn how to throw clay and pottery, make pottery. And so they have a clay arts studio. They would have people who would learn how to do blacksmithing and all sorts of crafts, all sorts of things at John C. Campbell Folk School. It's an amazing place. In the 30s, the 1930s, that is, when the Great Depression was going on, John Jacob Niles was there at John C. Campbell Folk School, and he was there teaching. But he happened to go in, I can't remember if it was Franklin or Murphy, North Carolina, whichever one is the county seat of that area, but he went and he heard this girl who was barely more than a waif with dirty hair, dirty clothes. She was the daughter of a traveling evangelist who was there on the courthouse square, and they dared to even hang out their wash on the Confederate monument. And she got up to sing. And she sang a song that many of you've heard, "I Wonder as I Wander Out Under the Sky." How Jesus the Savior did come forth to die for poor ornery creatures like you and like I. I wonder as I wander out under the sky. John Jacob Niles was mesmerized by the poignancy of her tune. And so he paid a quarter for her to keep singing it. A quarter each time she sang that same verse, the only verse she said, over and over again. And so after 8 quarters, $2 worth of money, he had memorized those words, "I wonder as I wander out under the sky, how Jesus the Savior did come for to die for poor ornery." And by the way, ornery really, in some versions of this, is ordinary, because ornery is a contraction of the word ordinary. But when I hear the word ornery, I think of someone who's cantankerous. Not ordinary, but a little bit mean-spirited. But she sang that song. He memorized the song, and John Jacob Niles added 2 verses to the song, and then the next December, it was sung for the first time at John C. Campbell Folk School. I wish I could sing it. I can in my heart. "I wonder as I wander out under the sky, how Jesus, my Savior, did come for to die for poor ornery creatures like you and like I. I wonder as I wander out under the sky." And aren't we all ordinary creatures? And most all of us, we would have to admit, at different points in our lives, we become ornery creatures as well. But Jesus comes for to die for all of us. And that is the good news of this passage of Scripture from Luke's gospel. You see, Luke has a penchant, a compulsion, a desire that all humankind might know who Jesus is. And so that's why he takes the genealogy back to Adam. And he lifts up throughout the Gospel of Luke this message of good news that's for all people. Everybody. No one is excluded. It's not by invitation only, except that the invitation goes to everyone. Come as you are, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And so Luke has the shepherds at the manger because he reaches out to the least, the lowest, the lost. You see, he has the shepherds. And shepherds, they were so disrespected. When I think of ancient Israel, I think of King David, who was a shepherd boy, took down Goliath. But by the time Jesus is born, shepherds are commonly assumed to be criminals. They could not even testify in court because it was assumed that whatever they said was a lie because they were sheep stealers. They were rustlers. And so Luke is trying to get across the point that the heavenly host sings out in the fields nearby to these poor shepherds who were astounded. And so they hurry off, leaving their flocks behind to find this Christ child in a manger, in a stable of all places, because Jesus came to identify with all of us and our poverty of soul and sometimes our poverty of resources. And if you look through the Gospel of Luke, you can see all sorts of things that are not in the other Gospels, not saying that one is right and one is wrong, but all together they give us the Word of God that leads us to salvation. For instance, it's only in Luke's Gospel, in Luke chapter 15, that we have the parable of the prodigal son. And where would we be if we didn't have the parable of the prodigal son? If Luke is trying to reach the poor people of all the Roman Empire who all feel like prodigals, if he's trying to reach you and me, us poor ordinary people, as we wander, we all are prodigals, aren't we? And it's Luke, it's only in Luke that there's the interaction between Jesus and the thieves on the cross beside him. Now, all four of the Gospels have Jesus surrounded by two thieves, but it's only in Luke's Gospel that you have one thief saying to Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And it's only in Luke's Gospel that you have that interaction between Jesus and this thief, and Jesus says to him, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." In paradise. Oh, Luke is trying to speak to all of us, rich and poor alike, to let us know that in God's kingdom, no one is excluded, that God loves everyone, that he gave his only begotten Son, true God of true God, as we have professed it, so that we might all have good news. There's so much more. There's a wonderful Christmas song, "Be Born in Me" by Francesca Battiselli. I encourage you to listen to it. In the second verse, it's a song, by the way, about Mary and her words of having a vacancy in her heart, a willingness for Jesus to be born in her, hence the title, "Be Born in Me." But in the second verse, she says this: "All this time we've waited for the promise. All this time you've waited for my arms. Did you wrap yourself inside the unexpected so we might know that love would go that far? Did you wrap your side? Did you wrap yourself inside the unexpected so that we might know that love would go that far?" And yes, Mary was an unexpected Christ bearer. And we too are unexpected members of this family of God. But God doesn't leave anyone out. And God wants to be born in all of us. He wants to be born in all of us. The late Henry Nouwen, Dutch priest, describes a small nativity scene that was in his parish church. It was a small nativity scene that would fit in the palm of a hand, these hand-carved pieces of a nativity scene. There was Joseph, and there was baby Jesus, and there was Mary, of course. They were just small, but would fit in the palm of a hand, and they were placed in front of the altar. But there was a floodlight in front of the altar beyond where the small carvings were. And when you turned on that floodlight, it cast a shadow over the entire back wall. And this is what Henry Nouwen says. God's light shines on this small, humble family cast. And in turn, they cast a large, hopeful shadow against the walls of our life and the world we live in. The good news for all of us this day is that Jesus wants to cast a large shadow of hope and light and forgiveness and grace over all of our lives. And he will use us as reflectors of that hope. But first, we must say, like Francesca Battistelli says, like Mary says in the Magnificat that's only in Luke's gospel, about her being a poor, humble servant, we must, like Mary, let Jesus be born in us. To cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us. It's good news for all people. One of my favorite actors through the years, because he was so authentic, he wasn't overdone. He was sort of a Glenn Ford type, another one of my favorites. A Fred McMurray type, what you see is what you get. A Donna Reed type, genuine. But Richard Crenna, C-R-E-N-N-A, some of you might remember him. I hope you do. If you can watch a movie with him in it, it's a good one. There are a couple that might be a little bit sketchy for those of you who are a bit more pacifist than not. I'm kind of one of them, but he plays a great character in it as well. But Richard Crenna, how many of you, don't raise your hands, you'll give away your age. How many of you remember The Real McCoys? Richard Crenna played Luke in The Real McCoys. He played Luke. But he also played, and this is where it gets a little tricky, he also played Colonel Sam Troutman in all the Rambo movies. He's a wonderful actor. He grew up in Hollywood, which must have been an interesting place to grow up in Hollywood. Well, he got his start on some comedy on radio before he ever did any TV or movies and things like that. But he lived with his mom and dad in kind of a rundown hotel that really wasn't a hotel in Hollywood. It was more like a bunch of apartments, kind of like a condo, but it was filled with people that he called the unfortunates. Starlets whose stars had dimmed long before. People who had addictions, who had fallen into the gutter of life. People who had not done well, but needed a place to stay. And his dad and mom welcomed them. And he made fun of them, the unfortunates. Crenna says that his family never celebrated a normal Christmas, that he envied his friends who talked about having a family Christmas tree and a big family dinner, because in their hotel, condo, whatever building, with all these unfortunates, they weren't allowed to have Christmas trees in their different apartments. They had one Christmas tree that was in the lobby. And he says whenever his friends would talk about having a big family dinner, he envied them because they always ate Chinese at a restaurant. But then news came. that he was going to have an audition in New York City and that he needed to take a train the day after Christmas to get to New York to try out for the part that led to him becoming Luke on The Real McCoys of all things. But nevertheless, he says he got on that, before he got on that train, that Christmas morning, the day before he left for New York City, his mom and dad said, "Son, we need to take you somewhere." And so they blindfolded him, and he agreed to it. And so they took him down the elevator and off the elevator, and the tree was decorated like never before. Ornaments had been added beyond what it had already had. It was somewhat bedraggled, but now it was glorious as he looked at it. And then he looked around as he adjusted his eyes, and he saw all these unfortunates, as he said, "I relentlessly mimicked and mocked. I saw all the unfortunates, and instead of their sad faces and their sad eyes, instead of all their pain, I saw smiles, and every one of them came up to me and wished me well on my trip to New York. They said they would be praying for me, and many of them gave me gifts. It was glorious," he says. And then the next day, as he was getting on the train, a man casually asked him, "How was your holiday?" The day after Christmas, "How was your holiday?" I could ask you the same thing. "How was your day yesterday?" And I imagine the answers would be quite different, because we're all different. But God loves us all. But Krenna said that these people, it was now clear, the men and women, and I quote from him, "The men and women I had once written off as has-been and weirdos were instead children of the Most High God." Children of the Most High God. And as I got on that train and that man asked me, "How was your holiday?" I said it was the very best Christmas I had ever had in my life. I spent it with my whole family. Those who were formerly the object of my ridicule were now my family. And then he concluded, only Christmas can do that. And I would add, only Christ can do that. To give us each good news, whatever good news you need to hear today, you specifically, individually, Christ does that for each of us. And he does it for all of us because we come together as a congregation seeking and imploring God to bless us, one and all, as Ebenezer Scrooge and Tim and the Cratchit family, as Tiny Tim says, "And God bless us, one and all." We all need it. And Luke shares it with us, because we are the shepherds. We are the unfortunates. We are the poor, ornery creatures. And God wants to let an angelic chorus sing above us and say, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace upon all people upon whom God's favor rests." And that includes all of us. Let us pray. Gracious God, you know what each one of us needs. And each one of us needs indeed that you be born in us. And help us, Lord, to know that that birth can occur when we find ourselves looking at the unexpected around us, and rather than writing them off as weirdos and unfortunates, we might see indeed that your love would go that far to include everyone. Oh, forgive us, Lord, for the ways that we write off others. And help us, Lord, to know that when we look around and we see in our family members how one family member might resemble some forebear some ancestor. Help us, Lord, to know that you dare to see yourself in us. You came to us. You died for us. You rose for us and will come again for us. Oh, Lord, give us hope and strength and grace and new life. In Jesus' name, amen. I would like to invite you to stand as we sing number 246, appropriately, Joy to the World. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the comfort and power of the Holy Spirit bless you and lead you into a marvelous new year. May God's presence be with you and live in you and us all through Christ. Amen. Go in peace.